سعيد أبو قريش. I work for Defense for Children International Palestine Section. DCI Palestine is affiliated to international movement around the world. There are about 40 sections. The relation between these sections is coordination relations. So each section develops its programs, activities according to the particular needs in each community. So some sections work on the issue of child labor, child pornography, street children, and so on. In Palestine, we work through two main programs, one on the Israeli level and the other one on the Palestinian level. The one under the Israeli level, we call it the accountability program, and it consists of the three main units. The first one, it's monitoring and documentation unit, where we document the Israeli violations to Palestinian children's rights. As a small organization, we do not have the capacity to document all the Israeli violations. So we concentrate on specific types of right violations, mainly the right to life, where we document killing and maiming, using children as human shields, as well as settler violence. For example, since the beginning of the second Intifada in September 2000, right now, we documented the killing of more than 2,000 Palestinian children as the result of the Israeli presence in the occupied Palestinian territories. The majority of this number is for children from Gaza Strip, mainly during the Israeli military attack against Gaza Strip. For example, during the last attack to Gaza Strip, we documented the killing of 547 Palestinian children. The circumstances of killing the children shows that Israel do not respect its obligation under international humanitarian law. Israel do not respect the principle of proportionality or the principle of distinction. And this was clear through the military tactics that Israel used during these military campaigns. For example, they used what's so called Dahi doctrine, and this military tactic has been used. Dahi, by the way, it's Arabic language, Arabic word, and it's mean neighborhood. And this military tactic has been used first in Lebanon or in Beirut in order to target the main area where Hezbollah is concentrated in the southern neighborhood of Lebanon in order to heavily attack and open fire in a very intensive way towards this area. And it has been used against Gaza Strip during all the Israeli military campaigns against Gaza Strip. And you know that Gaza Strip is a very heavily populated. So when Israel targets any residential area, many children will be killed as a result of these shillings. The other tactic, it's what's so called Hannibal directive, and usually they activate this directive whenever there is an attempt to capture an Israeli soldier. So when this directive is activated, they do not care about how many civilians will be killed, and even if opening the fire led to the killing of the Israeli soldiers. So, because this is, Israel do not want to find itself in a situation where they have to negotiate with Palestinian groups in order to make prisoners exchange. So the issue of the prisoners and imprisonment, it's a tool for suppress and control. The other right that we concentrate on or document in a very comprehensive way, it's the right to liberty. And under this right, we document the ill treatment and torture that Palestinian children are exposed to, and the lack of fair trial rights, as well as the issue of the arbitrary detention. For example, and mainly when we talk about arbitrary detention, we talk about administrative detention. For example, between October 2015 and now, DCI Palestine documented the cases of 24 Palestinian children who were put under administrative order detention. So This is the in relation to the work of monitoring and documentation. We document other right violations, but not in a comprehensive way, like the right to liberty and right to life. The other unit is the legal unit, where we represent or provide free legal services for Palestinian children before the Israeli military legal system. Every year we represent about 150 Palestinian children before the Israeli military courts, as well as taking evidence from children where they inform us about the ill treatment and torture that they expose to. In addition to that, our lawyers file complaints in some cases where the Israeli authorities ill treat or torture a Palestinian child. And the main purpose of filing these complaints to show how the system is operating and to highlight the issue of impunity that Palestinian Israeli soldiers enjoy when it comes to violating the rights of Palestinian children. So the information that we collect from legal unit and from monitoring and documentation unit, we use it by another unit, which is advocacy unit, in order to report about the Israeli violations against Palestinian children. So we submit reports to UN bodies like the Committee on the Rights of the Child, Torture Committee, special procedures within UN, in order to invite countries to put pressure on Israel to abide to its obligation under the international human rights law. In fact, sometimes it's very difficult for us to choose the departure point from where to talk when it comes to the violation of Palestinian children's rights, whether to start from the violation to the right to liberty, or to right to life, or to settler violence, or but from wherever you started, all these issues are interconnected, because the main purpose of all these violations is to suppress and control people who are living under the Israeli occupation. So when we talk about the issue of child prisoners, every year the Israeli authorities arrest and prosecute between 500 to 700 Palestinian children before the military legal system. The number of children who may be arrested could be more, but they may be arrested and after that released without being prosecuted before the Israeli military legal system. So usually the Israeli authorities invade the area where children are living, surrounded their house during night hours. In some cases, they may force their way in to the child house, ask all family members to assemble in one place. After that, they identify the child that they want to arrest. They do not inform the child or his family about the reason for arresting the child or to where the child will be taken. And in some cases, they may start beating the child in front of other family members. So after that, they take the child to one of the military jeeps that waiting outside. They put the child on the metal floor of the military jeep under the legs of the Israeli soldiers and transport him to one of the interrogation centers that usually based or located inside Israeli settlement. And during the trip between the child house and the interrogation center, children exposed to different types of ill treatment and torture. And also they are threatened and intimidated. And the main purpose of this practice is to prepare the child for the interrogation process. So in the morning, the child will be interrogated by an Israeli interrogator without being accompanied by a family member. And also there is no audiovisual recording for the interrogation process, and the child is not informed about his rights during the interrogation. So the Israeli interrogators use different types of ill treatment and torture in order to extract confession from child. Sometimes they use physical methods of torture, other times they use psychological methods of torture. And during the last period, we noticed that the Israeli interrogators rely more on psychological methods of torture. This is simply because they discovered that using psychological methods of torture is more fruitful for them in order to extract confession from the child. Because the main philosophy of the interrogation is to put as much pressure on the person who is under interrogation and to keep his resistance as low as possible. So whenever the Israeli interrogators start beating, kicking, or whatever forms of physical violence against the person who is under interrogation, this person will collect all his strength in order to resist. But when the interrogator intimidates the child or threatening him, like threatening the child that he will arrest other family members or use militant techniques of interrogation or put the child in solitary confinement or throw the child from the third floor or whatever. And among other forms of psychological pressure is solitary confinement, where the child is put in a cell that measures 2 by 1 meter. Without having any communication with a human being. And also, when the child is, some children report to us that even when they were in solitary confinement, food had been served to them through a flap in the door. So the main purpose of putting children in solitary confinement for the interrogation purposes is to make the child collapse from within, because the child, when he is in solitary confinement, he can't identify what's the source of the miserable situation that he is under. So he starts to blame himself that I am here in this situation because I did something wrong and so on. At some point, the child is invited for, after being held in solitary confinement for interrogation, and he is ready enough to give up a confession to the allegation against him. For example, between 2012 and now, we documented the cases of more than 100 Palestinian children who were brought in solitary confinement for an average number of days of 15 days. So, just to share with you one of the stories. Once, as I told you, that our lawyers visit children after finishing their interrogation in order to get the information about how they have been treated. So, usually because children have a problem in describing what happened with them, so we ask our lawyers to start in a chronological order with the child to inform you about the story, how he has been arrested, how he has been transferred, what types of ill treatment he exposed to, and so on. So our lawyer asked the child about all these phases, so the child informed him how he has been arrested, transferred, and so on. So when he asked him about the interrogation, he said that the interrogator is a very kind man, even he is better than my father. How come the interrogator is better than his father? But later on, our lawyer discovered that this child has been put in solitary confinement for 22 days. And the first interaction between the child and the human being was with the Israeli interrogator. So it was enough for the interrogator to approach the child, to offer him a cigarette, and he would regard that the interrogator is a gift from the sky, and he will do his best in order to make the time that he is spending with the interrogator as long as possible. And usually the best way is to give a confession to the interrogation, to the allegation against the child. And here, by the way, I'm not saying that all Palestinian children are whiter than driven snow. Some of them commit the offenses that they are accused of, while others do not. But regardless whether they commit these offenses or not, still they have rights, and these rights should be protected.